It gives me great pleasure to welcome our speaker today, Eric Dolin, who's a very well-known author who happens to live locally. Eric has been here, I think this is your third time, and through the years, Eric and I have become friends. And actually thinking about it, we share a few things in common. We're both natives of Long Island who managed to migrate north into the civilized New England area. And one of the reasons we did so is we both went to school here in New England, and we both married native ladies who live here in New England. And in fact, two of the three schools we went to are in common. Eric did his undergraduate at Brown, and then got a master's degree from Yale, and a doctor's degree from MIT. And I happen to have gone to Yale undergraduate and got a graduate degree from MIT, so we have that in common as well. But Eric went a step further and got a doctorate's degree. And actually, and I'm serious about this, he's one of the few people I know who has a doctorate's degree and doesn't pass himself off as Dr. So-and-so. I really respect that. And in fact, the co-organizer of your American Issues class, Jill, I found out has a doctor's degree. And I know Jill for about almost 10 years before I found that out. So I respect people who get the degree and don't flaunt it. The other thing Eric and I have in common is nonfiction books. I like to read them. He writes them. And very briefly, the first one that, well, he wrote a number of books on special interest topics, but then he kind of went mainstream, I'll call it. And his first one was A History of Whaling in America, Leviathan. And they're all on sale here today. The second one was History of the Fur Trade in America, Fur, Fortune, and Empire. The third was When America Met China, in other words, the history of Chinese-American relations. And then his last book that he'll talk about today, Brilliant Beacons, is A History of Lighthouses in America. Now, all of these books will be available for sale and for signing after the talk, and you'll save at least $5 a copy versus commercial prices. So I think, with no further ado, Eric, let me let you speak. And the other point that I forgot to make was, you might say, well, why are we combining the American Issues class with the, why are we combining the American Issues class with the Greater Boston class? Because you'll find that there are issues associated with lighthouses. Basically, the government is getting out of the lighthouse business, and so how do they do that, and what happens to all of these iconic landmarks?
Thank you for that introduction. I really appreciate it. Brilliant Beacons tells the fascinating story of these soaring coastal sentinels. Now, one of the questions that I'm asked most often is, how do I come up with the ideas for my books? Typically, I spend a lot of time in the library. I walk up and down aisles. I grab books that look interesting. I try to find a topic that hasn't already been written to death or hasn't been written in the way that I want to write the book. And then I try to convince my literary agent that we have a book worth submitting to my longtime editor at W.W. Norton. There's absolutely no guarantee that my editor at Norton is going to like my book idea. In fact, he has shot down a couple of topics I've wanted to write about, but maybe I'll write about them later on in my career. But with Brilliant Beacons, the story was totally reversed. I had just finished a book called When America First Met China, and I was flailing around for a new book topic when my longtime editor sent an email to my agent, and they wanted to know if I was interested in writing on lighthouses. I said, I have absolutely no idea. Because at that moment, I knew virtually nothing about lighthouses. In fact, I had only seen two lighthouses in my whole life, closer than about 150 feet. So I asked for a month to think it over. I went home and I read a bunch of books, and I was absolutely floored. I had no idea that lighthouses were so interesting, or that you could weave so many threads of the American experience through a book on lighthouses. Far from being just a story about lighthouses, it was a story about colonial commerce, nation building, War, technological innovation, engineering feats, personal inspiration, tragedy, art, hope, and poetry. And that was just in one chapter, so I knew that this was going to be a good book to write. I submitted a proposal, it was accepted, and about 2 years later, which is usually the average amount of time it takes me to work on a book, I submitted the finished manuscript. And just so you know, I have written 12 books so far, and every single one of them has been on a topic that I knew virtually nothing about before I began the project. And you may think that's because I don't know much about anything, which is not necessarily true, although some people might argue it. But it's really because I want to stay excited for the 2 years it takes me to write a book. And if I pick a topic I don't know a lot about, then I'm guaranteed to be surprised every week, and hopefully some of that surprise will make its way onto the page. Also, my background, even though I went to school for many, many years, and in fact, my wife, when she married me, she used to introduce me, my nickname was Debt, because I had so many student loans out at the time. I wasn't a history major. The only history class I took was the one as a freshman in college. I wish I could go back and take more. So it's not as if I've been studying one little area for many, many years. I sort of have to delve around and find what excites me. But what I'm going to do right now is just read a short excerpt, relatively short excerpt from the book, the introduction, to give you a sense. It really paints a picture of what is in the book and why I was so excited to write about it. Sorry, if I was a little taller, you could see me better, but to give you, here's the history of America's lighthouses is wondrously wide-ranging. It's about the far-sighted colonists that built the first lighthouses on the East Coast to welcome commerce to their shores, embracing the founding of the nation and its dramatic expansion across the continent. When the inaugural Federal Congress convened in 1789, one of the first issues it took up was whether the federal government or the state would be in charge of lighthouses. In one of its earliest acts, Congress made lighthouses a federal concern. From that point forward, as the country grew, so too did the number of lighthouses, creating a necklace of beacons and literally lighting the way for the settlement of new territories and states. Brilliant Beacons is also a history of government ineptitude and international competition. For a long time, America's lighthouses were vastly inferior to those in Great Britain and France, even though many stubborn and misguided American officials refused to concede that fact. Only by emulating its cross-ocean rivals was America able to elevate its lighthouse system from one mired in mediocrity to one that was among the best in the world. The book is likewise a history of lighting innovation. Lighthouse illuminance changed dramatically over time, running the gamut from whale, lard, and vegetable oil to kerosene, acetylene, and finally electricity. Similarly, crude lamps gave way to more sophisticated ones, and reflectors that did a poor job of projecting the light were replaced by the crown jewels of lighthouse illumination, Fresnel lenses, which not only increased the intensity of the light, but also became one of the most important and strikingly beautiful inventions of the 19th century. Most of these elegant lenses have since been supplanted by modern optics, which are far less arresting to the eye, yet still effective in casting refulgent beams toward the horizon. Lighthouse towers have undergone substantial structural changes. While early towers are made of wood and rubble stone, in later years, cut stone, bricks, iron, steel, reinforced concrete, and even aluminum became the materials of choice. This is the last large lighthouse to be built in the United States. It's unique for two reasons. One, it's the only lighthouse in the country that ever had an elevator. And it's the only one with air conditioning. Apparently it gets really hot in that skin. Although all lighthouses require skill to build, a few pose such significant challenges that they are truly marvels of engineering, serving as testaments to human ingenuity. America's military history is one in which lighthouses have played a crucial role. They served as lookout towers in many conflicts, but during the American Revolution and the Civil War, they also became key strategic targets, resulting in more than 160 of them being damaged or completely destroyed. Like wars, natural disasters, especially hurricanes, have taken a terrible toll on lighthouses. The great hurricane of 1938 stands out, both the extent of devastation it wreaked and for the gripping and tragic stories of survival and death that it left in its wake. At its core, however, the dramatic history of America's lighthouses is about people, and an intriguingly diverse cast of compelling characters brings that history to vivid life. These include founding fathers, skillful engineers, imperiled mariners, and intrepid soldiers, as well as saboteurs, penny-pinching bureaucrats, ruthless egg collectors, and inspiring leaders. Undoubtedly, the most important actors are the male and female keepers, who, often with the invaluable assistance of their families, faithfully kept the lights shining and the fog signals blaring. No one who has studied the history of these keepers could claim that their lives were a proverbial picnic, for they contended with loneliness, monotony, and a myriad of dangers. Not surprisingly, a few died in the line of duty. Many keepers rescued people in distress on the water, some performing so heroically that they were awarded, that America's highest award for life-saving was bestowed on them. Above all, keepers provided a vital public service that was at once noble and altruistic. The 1900s saw the role of keepers diminish over time. As lighthouses were decommissioned or became automated, the number of keepers dwindled, and today only Boston Light, shown here, still has one. And if you have never visited Boston Light and you want something fun to do next summer, go take the boat ride out to the lighthouse. They just finished a multi-million dollar renovation, and it's a wonderful boat ride. You get to see the harbor and also our first lighthouse. But as keepers faded from view and lighthouses began suffering from neglect, nonprofit organizations, government agencies, and private individuals stepped forward to become the new stewards of an increasing number of lighthouses, ensuring that they will be cared for and preserved for the benefit of future generations. Lighthouses are among the most beloved and romanticized structures in the American landscape. It's not difficult to find evidence of their hold on the public's imagination. Lighthouses are emblazoned on postage stamps and license plates, while legions of artists portray them on their canvases. Many cities and towns incorporate lighthouses into their official seals. And even more businesses and organizations use lighthouses in their logos and advertising. Scores of books, movies, and television shows employ lighthouses as subjects, plot elements, or dramatic settings. And millions of people visit lighthouses every year. The inherent beauty of lighthouses, starkly etched against the sky, is undeniably a big part of what makes them so alluring. But America's intrinsic fascination with lighthouses runs deeper than that. Over three centuries, these brilliant beacons have indelibly woven themselves into the American fabric, and it is this rich history more than anything else that draws us in. Now, writing a book focuses your mind on whatever you're working on. Before I started this book, I never thought about lighthouses. After I began it, that's all I could think about. I was dreaming about them. Now, this is not my front lawn. But although I had driven from my house to the local mall, the North Shore Mall, which probably you're familiar with, hundreds of times, never before had I noticed that along the way, there were at the time four houses that had 4-foot tall wooden lighthouses in their front lawns. Two of them had light bulbs in their lantern rooms as if they were guiding motorists on their way home. I also learned that some people do not like lighthouses at all. I saw an ad for an art competition in Maine, and they had a long list of submission guidelines. And the very first guideline was, please, no paintings of lighthouses. Now, I like lighthouse paintings if they're well done. This is kind of a wild painting. It's done by Andrew Wyeth of, no, Jamie Wyeth. So Andrew's, I love Andrew too. But Jamie Wyeth is son of the famous Wyeth family. And this is a painting called Lighthouse Dandelions. It's of the Tennant's Harbor lighthouse up overlooking Penobscot Bay. And he uses it as a studio and as a residence. Now, I too have become one of those people who loves lighthouses, and I even have a few lighthouse-themed objects in my home. Whenever I write a book, after I'm done, I try to buy something that reminds me of the book. When I finished Leviathan, I was naive enough to think that when I finished the book, I would be able to buy a piece of scrimshaw. But as if to poke a finger in my eye, right when the book got published, they made the all-time record for sale of a single piece of scrimshaw, $325,000. Now, Leviathan did very well. It didn't do that well. So I had to satisfy myself with a wooden sperm whale, which is still hanging over the front door of our house to this day. For Brilliant Beacons, I bought this tile. It's about 3 by 4 inches. It's called a calendar tile. I bought it out at Brimfield. My son begged me to go to Brimfield so he can get old comic books, and I tagged along, which is great because I grew up, my mom was an antique dealer. So this is called a calendar tile, and you'll see why in a second. It was made in 1918 by the Wedgwood Company, and it was sold in downtown Boston. Here's why it's called calendar tile, because in the back there's this calendar, and that little hole up top, you would run a string through it and hang it in your kitchen. I framed it, and now it's in our house. I also bought a can of Lighthouse cleanser up at a yard sale in Kennebunkport, and when my wife got our 2016 calendar, without telling me, of course she got one that features lighthouses. Now, one of the most difficult things about writing this book is deciding, or writing any book, is deciding what stories and personalities to include. With this book, it was particularly difficult. There are well over 1,000 lighthouses built in the United States. Each one of them has a story worth telling. But I didn't want to write a book that was 3,000 pages long, which nobody, not even my mother, would read. So I had to cut out a lot of stories. And one of the ones I cut out is kind of fun, so I'm going to tell you about it. After the Titanic was sunk by an iceberg in April of 1912, people, of course, wanted to figure out a way to keep such a disaster from ever taking place again. So one concerned citizen wrote to the Commissioner of Lighthouses with what he thought was a brilliant idea. He urged the commissioner to place lighthouses on all large icebergs to warn ships away before they crash into them. Obviously not a very practical idea. To give you an idea of the great beauty and diversity of the lighthouses that are in the book, I'm going to show you some pictures of some of them. And keep in mind that all of these images are in the book, minus, I think, three of them. This is the Portland Head Lighthouse in Portland, Maine. It was built in 1791. It is the first lighthouse in Maine. At that time, Maine was part of Massachusetts. And it was a favorite of the poet Henry Wadsworth Longfellow, who grew up in Portland. And he used to amble down to the lighthouse and talk to the local lighthouse keepers. And it is thought that this lighthouse serves as the inspiration for a number of his poems that feature lighthouses or lighthouse imagery. And I'm going to read you the introduction or the opening stanza to one of those poems, which is actually called The Lighthouse. The rocky ledge runs far into the sea, and on its outer point, some miles away, the lighthouse lifts its massive masonry, a pillar of fire by night, of cloud by day. Now here's the Borden Flats Lighthouse at the mouth of the Taunton River in Massachusetts. And believe it or not, today it serves as a bed and breakfast, although you have to bring your own breakfast. I'm told that the bathroom is on the first floor in a closet. But it's pretty nice. This is one of the rooms at the Borden Flats Lighthouse, one of the old keeper's rooms. And here is the Currier Knives print of the Statue of Liberty from 1885. And what I didn't know is that the Statue of Liberty was intended not only to serve as a welcoming symbol to the weary and downtrodden of the world, it was also meant to be an active lighthouse. And in fact, it served as a functioning lighthouse for a couple of years before it was decommissioned, because the lighting structure was not, the flame was not set up very well. Now here's probably the most famous lighthouse in the country, the Cape Hatteras Lighthouse. It's the tallest one, 193 feet tall, often called America's Lighthouse. This lighthouse, which is the third Cape Hatteras Lighthouse and was built in 1871, took 1 million bricks to construct. Now, you might remember that in 1999, this lighthouse was moved, tallest brick structure ever to be moved. It was moved 1,500 feet inland, away from the surf to keep it from toppling into the ocean. It took about a month, it cost $12 million, and they used hydraulics, and then those rails that you see there, they put soap on them to reduce the friction, push the lighthouse along. Now, two companies worked in tandem to move this lighthouse, and every single lighthouse that has been moved in the United States has been moved by these two countries. It's about 10 lighthouses. Now, I thought I had a great idea. Before the book comes out, before any book comes out, you have something called an advance review copy, which is a cheap paperback version that still has a lot of typos in it that you send out to reviewers and people who might want to carry your book. So I got a hold of two of those, and I sent one each to the presidents of these two companies. And I thought that they would fall in love with the book and buy copies for every single person that worked for them. As far as I know, that didn't happen. But they were nice enough to send me stuff. One sent me a letter, but the other guy sent me a care package, and in it was a t-shirt. And the t-shirt had a very muscular guy on it. It was sort of a cross between Mr. Clean and the Incredible Hulk. And he, in one arm, he's holding the Block Island Southeast Lighthouse, which was moved, and in the other arm, he's dragging the Cape Hatteras Lighthouse. And on the back of the shirt, it says that I am part of the expert lighthouse moving team. And I can tell you, if you want to start a conversation with a perfect stranger, wear that t-shirt, especially on Cape Cod. I cannot tell you, I've worn it a couple times on the Cape in particular. People come up to me on the street, tap me on the shoulder, and they go, "Do you move lighthouses?" And I have to let them down slowly because I'm just a boring writer, but it's a great conversation starter. But there were two other things in the care package. One was a baseball cap. The other one really surprised me. It was a bandana. And on the bandana were a skull and crossbones. And the reason it surprised me, you know, sort of like pirates, is that this guy had no way of knowing that at that moment, and still to this day, I'm writing a book on pirates. So I thought that was a nice coincidence. Now here's the St. George Reef Lighthouse during construction. It was finished in 1892. It took 10 years to build, cost one life, and it cost $752,000. It's a lot of money back then. It's the most ever spent on a lighthouse in the United States. And here is the Minot's Ledge Lighthouse. It was located about 9 miles southeast of Boston Harbor and about a mile off the coast of Cohasset, Massachusetts. It was built in 1849, and if you could see underneath that the wave there, you'd see Minot's Ledge, which is about 25 to 35 foot wide, uneven ledge of rock. And they drilled holes into the rock. They put these iron piles in there. They cemented them in place. This lighthouse only lasted for 2 years before a nor'easter obliterated it, killing the two keepers within. But right before they died, one of the keepers was able to write a note saying that he feared that the lighthouse wasn't going to make it until the morning. And he put that note in a glass bottle, pitched it over the side, and it was discovered 2 days later by a Gloucester fisherman. And if you ever go to Cohasset, go down to the water. They have a wonderful memorial to those two keepers. Now, this was a very dangerous part of the coast. They still needed a lighthouse there. So they built this one. It was finished in 1860 on the eve of the Civil War. This is the current Minot's Ledge Lighthouse. It's 114 feet high. It's made of Quincy granite. Those blocks each are 2 to 5 tons apiece. And they're held together. If you see this, these are iron dowels, and it's sort of a jigsaw-like puzzle that keeps them able. It keeps the lighthouse and maintains its ability to withstand the pounding Atlantic. But just think about that. It took 4 years to build this. This is before electricity. It's all manual labor, levers, a mile offshore. Just an amazing feat. And some of you might know that this lighthouse is called the Lover's Light or the I Love You Light. Because of its characteristic flash pattern, which is one flash, four flashes, three flashes, which corresponds numerically to the words I love you. But I can tell you, as somebody who spent 10 years working for the federal government in various capacities, that the government bureaucrat who gave it that flashing characteristic in 1896 did not have love on his mind. That was some later Romeo gave it that appellation. Now here is the Cape Flattery Lighthouse on Tatoosh Island in Washington. This is the most westerly part of the contiguous United States, and if you could see it, that's a big cliff. In the late 1800s, one of the keepers flung himself off that cliff. He was very despondent, lonely, but he survived, and the two other keepers went down and gathered him up, brought him to the mainland, deposited him in a hospital, and then he was promptly fired by the lighthouse board. Now, does this look familiar to anybody? It does? No. Everybody thinks it's Brant Point in Nantucket. They're both squat. It looks sort of like that. But if you remember, Nantucket is just a sand spit out in the ocean. Look at all those rocks. This is it's the Marshall Point Lighthouse in Port Clyde, Maine. But the reason I wanted to know if you recognized it is it was in a famous movie. You ever hear the phrase, life is like a box of chocolates? Forrest Gump. If you saw the movie Forrest Gump, you'll remember that Tom Hanks, the star, becomes a cult-like figure in the movie, and he runs back and forth across the United States. This is the eastern terminus of his run. And if you go to this lighthouse, they have a wonderful museum and a scrapbook that has pictures of Tom Hanks spending 2 days there filming this scene, which only lasts, I think, 3 seconds in the movie. Now here, if you could see it, it's right at the top of that pinnacle. This is the Makapu Point Lighthouse in Oahu, Hawaii. And here is the enormous Fresnel lens that sits in that lighthouse. It's the largest Fresnel lens ever made. It's called a hyperradiant lens. It's 12 feet high, weighs 14 tons, and has 1,188 prisms. It's the only one of its type in the United States, and there are only a few of them made in the world. Here's a sunset overlooking Lake Michigan, Indiana, at the Michigan City East Pierhead Lighthouse. And this is a 30-second time exposure image of the Ludington North Breakwater Lighthouse in Ludington, Michigan. And here's one closer to home. If any of you ever sailed on Long Island Sound, you probably recognize this. This is the New London Ledge Lighthouse. It was built in 1909. Now, it's very unusual, sort of a classic lighthouse. And if you saw that in the street in Wellesley, you wouldn't look, you think it'd fit right in. Now, as with every single lighthouse in the country, every single lighthouse in the country seems to have a ghost story associated with it. So does this one. There apparently was a keeper there named Ernie. Now, the story is different depending on who tells it. The way I told it is he had a wife who cheated on him, and he pitched her off the roof, killing her. Or another people say that his wife cheated on him, and he got depressed, and he pitched himself off the roof. Either way, there's no record of there ever being a keeper at this lighthouse named Ernie, nor is there any murder recorded there. But if you go to New London, they will not let facts get in the way of a good story. Now here's the lantern room. That's ice. Lantern room of the Michigan St. Joseph Pier Lighthouse in December of 2010, right after a storm kicked up waves 20 feet high in Lake Michigan, coating the tower and the lantern room. Just amazing. And here is, how many of you have been to Marblehead? And Marblehead Neck is sort of a spit peninsula that's right next to the harbor. This is the Marblehead Lighthouse, the original Marblehead Lighthouse. It was built in 1835. It's only 23 feet tall. And by the way, Marblehead is where I live now. It's only 23 feet tall, and it worked great for about 3 decades. But then wealthy people, predominantly from Boston, started to build what were called summer cottages on the neck, which most of us would call mansions today. And if you want to buy something on the neck, now's the time. I went for a bike ride around there. Half the houses on the neck seem to be for sale. But anyway, these summer cottages got in the way of the light. And back then, we still had a lot of fishermen in Marblehead, and they complained. And the lighthouse board decided it needed to do something. So it put that pole, see that pole in the background? Put that pole up, and every night they would raise 2 kerosene lanterns to the top of the pole. Now, that's not a very effective solution. So they decided to build a 100-foot-tall brick lighthouse. But at the last moment, they decided to save money, and they built this. which is the lighthouse that is now in Marblehead, a skeletal tower lighthouse. These lighthouses were designed for hurricane-prone areas and are predominantly down south, way down south. Because think about it, they have a low profile to the wind and waves that can go right through them. This is the only skeletal tower in New England, and the next one down the coast is Coney Island. I'd say about half the people in town hate this thing. About half love it. I am sort of non-committal. But it is our lighthouse, and the symbolism, it's all over town. Now here is a painting about 18 by 20 inches. This is in the book, and this is the most important image in the whole book to me. And this is a painting of the Edgartown Lighthouse on Martha's Vineyard. And it was painted by my daughter, Lily, before she went off to college. She and her grandmother, who's a professional painter, used to go to Newbury Street once every 3 months and take a painting class from a master painter. And one day she went in, she saw a photograph of this lighthouse. So she painted it that day and she brought it home and she gave me that as a present. And she goes, "Dad, do you know why I gave this to you?" And I said, "Because you love me." And she said, "Nah, I just want you to finish this damn book." So it was meant to be, I shouldn't say that word in here, I'm sorry. But anyway, it was meant to be a motivational tool, and it worked. I framed it and hung it in my office. Now, writing this book was fun because there are so many great stories, and I'm just going to tell you a couple of them that are woven throughout it. There are a lot of women characters in this book, which is not the case for my last couple of books. There weren't that many whaling women, although there were whaling wives, and there weren't that many female trappers, although there were women involved in the trapping business. But in this book, there were nearly 400 women who were lighthouse keepers, either primary keepers or assistant keepers, and this between the 1700s and early 1900s, at a time when it was very unusual for women to have any kind of job outside of the house, much less one that was so responsible. And believe it or not, I double-checked this a couple of times because I was shocked when I heard it, most women keepers were paid the same as male keepers, even in the mid-1800s. Now, a lot of them were the wives of male keepers who died, so it was a convenient and made sense. These women knew how to operate the lighthouse, and they would probably be destitute otherwise. But there are a lot of great stories, and this is one of the best. This is Emily Fish. She was married to a doctor named Melancton Fish. They lived in San Francisco. They were very wealthy. They used to throw a lot of parties. And her husband dropped out of a heart attack when he was 65, and she had a son-in-law who was affiliated with the Lighthouse Board. He said, "Hey, I heard this great job. You want to be lighthouse keeper at Fort Point Pinos Lighthouse in Pacific Grove, California?" She said, "Sure." So at age 50, she became lighthouse keeper. She was a lighthouse keeper for 21 years. She was called the socialite keeper because all those parties she had in San Francisco, she moved them to the lighthouse. In fact, if you know the Great White Fleet, the story of the Great White Fleet, Teddy Roosevelt going around the world, when it pulled into California, into San Francisco, she was in charge of organizing the festivities. And her daughter became a lighthouse keeper too. Now here's George Washington. He's greeting the Continental soldiers on July 3rd, 1775. And two of the most enjoyable chapters in the book for me to write were the ones about the American Revolution and the Civil War, when lighthouses became pawns and were battled over. George Washington actually ordered the attack on Boston Light and Sandy Hook Lighthouse in New Jersey during the Revolution. And what you may know is that the Boston Light that you see now is not the original. It was the one that was built in 1783, because when the British left Boston Harbor on March 17th of 1776, evacuation day, they were not too happy with the American colonists. So they blew up the lighthouse on their way out of the harbor. So we had to build a new one. Now there's a whole chapter in the book on lighthouse heroes, the people that risked their lives to save others, and none were more famous than this woman, Ida Lewis. She was the keeper at the Lime Rock Lighthouse in Newport, Rhode Island, which today is the Ida Lewis Yacht Club, if you go there. She's credited with saving 18 people from drowning. She was only about 5 foot tall, 100 pounds, but a very strong rower. And the problem for her is she became one of the most famous people in the country. She was hounded by paparazzi. She got unwanted marriage proposals. 10,000 people came to visit her in a single summer. They took things out of the keeper's quarters to have a piece of Ida Lewis. And the problem was, she was a very shy and retiring person. She didn't like this attention at all, but she kept to her job and ended up died on duty. Now here's the Scotch Cap Lighthouse on Unalaska. Unimak Island in the end of the Aleutian chain in Alaska. This was called by the Russians the Roof of Hell, and that's because it had a lot of volcanic activity. But in the early morning hours of April 1st, 1946, a 100-foot tall wall of water from a tsunami crashed into this lighthouse and destroyed it and killed all five keepers within. And the following days, all they found was a kneecap and some intestines. Now here's a more uplifting story. This is the Flying Santa. Some of you may even know about it. It started in 1929 out of Rockland, Maine. There was a pilot named Bill Winklepaw who used to deliver things up and down the coast and also save people at sea. And he had been helped back to the airfield on many a bad weather night by the gleam of the lighthouses along the coast. So he decided that he wanted to say thank you to all these selfless lighthouse keepers. So on Christmas of 1929, he got in his plane and he dropped presents on lighthouses around Rockland. And this program continues to this day. It's run by the Friends of Flying Santa. They don't use a plane like that anymore. They use a helicopter and they drop the presents on Coast Guard stations. But many of you are probably familiar with the name Edward Rowe Snow. I would have loved to have met him, a real great storyteller, very prolific writer, and he wrote a lot about lighthouses. But he was Flying Santa for, I think, almost 40 years. And at one point, he was dropping presents on a couple of hundred lighthouses each year. Now, there's a great chapter in the book on the invention of the Fresnel lens, and I learned a lot about optics. They're often called glass beehives on account of the unusual way that they look. And here is a Fresnel lens, a first-order Fresnel lens, the largest one that's typically used in a major seacoast light like Minot's Ledge. And there's the watch room beneath and the lens up top. And here is the person who invented the Fresnel lens, the Frenchman, Augustin Jean Fresnel. Now, in addition to these stories that I've told you about, there are hundreds of other stories in the book that are woven through a 300-year narrative. And one thing I promised to myself, my last four books have pretty much all covered three centuries. The China book's a little less. My pirate book is going to cover about a century and a half, but I vowed I'm going to come up with an idea that covers like 2 years or has one person in it, one character, because I want to see what it's like to write that kind of book. But the most exciting chapter in the history of America's lighthouses is being written right now, and it has its roots reaching back to the mid-1900s when America's lighthouses were going through a really difficult period. Many lighthouses that were no longer needed for navigational purposes on account of advances in long-range and short-range radar were decommissioned. And other lighthouses were automated, meaning that they no longer needed a lighthouse keeper. This created a real problem for the Coast Guard. Coast Guard took over control of lighthouses in 1939. And the Coast Guard had a really huge mission, limited staff, and a limited budget. So they decided to focus on maintaining the quality of the lights and the buildings, not the buildings, and the fog signals. So as a result, the towers, the lighthouse keeper, the keeper's quarters started to fall into disrepair. Now just at a time when this was getting real bad, help arrived. Starting in the mid-1960s and up through the present, a great array of nonprofit groups, government agencies have stepped forward to become the new keepers of lighthouses to preserve them. This is the East Brother Lighthouse. It's out near San Francisco. It's on an island. It was built in 1870. It is today a bed and breakfast. And if you go there, I'm told that they'll pick you up in a boat, they'll take you to the island, they'll give you champagne, they'll put chocolate on your pillow, They'll give you a tour of the lighthouse, and it only costs $425 a night. So I told that story when I gave this talk out in California. And there was a guy sitting in the front row with his wife, and he raised his hands and he goes, "I took my wife there for her birthday 20 years ago, and it was a lot cheaper than that." And we're sort of looking at it. And then he said, "Oh no, she's still worth it. I would have taken her out." But anyway, I hear it's very nice. I've never been there. Now, in the year 2000, the federal government got involved in lighthouse preservation in a really big way. They passed the National Historic Lighthouse Preservation Act. And basically, under this law, any lighthouse station that they no longer need, like the buildings and the land, they can transfer to a nonprofit group or a government agency for free of charge. If nobody steps forward, they'll sell the lighthouse through a public auction. Now, so far, nearly 80 lighthouses have been transferred to government agencies and nonprofit groups, and almost 50 lighthouses have been sold to private individuals. The Minas Ledge Lighthouse, for example, was recently sold to the former chairman of the Polaroid Corporation for $225,000. But the prices have varied widely. The cheapest lighthouse sold thus far is the Cleveland Harbor East Breakwater Lighthouse, sold a while ago for $10,000. The most expensive is near here. It's a little bit beyond the mouth of Boston Harbor. You take a left towards the Hunt, you hit this lighthouse, Graves Lighthouse, and it was bought by the Waller family a couple of years back for $934,000. And I don't know how much they've sunk into it, but it's probably equaled that. They're doing a phenomenal job renovating it, even to the point of hiring furniture makers to make furniture with rounded backs so it maximizes the use of space in this tower. Now, it's really a great time to visit lighthouses or to learn about them, not because of my book necessarily, but because there are 700 lighthouses still standing, and almost half of them can be visited, and some of them you can climb the towers, others have museums. For three centuries, lighthouses have illuminated America's shores. They and their dependable keepers have done a fantastic job protecting cargo, passengers, ships, and it is literally true that the success and growth of the American economy could not have been achieved without the service of lighthouses and their keepers. So I think that it's really appropriate that now, in greater numbers, we as citizens are turning around and taking care of the lighthouses for present and future generations. And before I finish up, I'm going to tell you a couple of quick stories. I have signed a lot of strange things in my books over the years, but one of the strangest was when I gave a talk at the Stanford Yacht Club. I grew up in Stanford, although I never had seen the yacht club, but they invited me down to give a talk. And after the talk, a woman came up with her boyfriend, and she's laughing, and she goes, "I know exactly what I want you to write in my book." I said, "What?" She said, "Dearest Elaine, you mean the world to me, and I couldn't have written this book without you. Love, Eric." So I said, the bookseller was sitting next to me. I said, "Should I write that?" And she said, "I don't know, it's your book." So I wrote it, but I will tell you, later that night when I told my wife, she was not amused. But the all-time best story happened in Cohasset. Cohasset loves their lighthouse, Minas Ledge. It's plastered on everything in the town. In fact, over a span of 2 days last May, I gave 6 talks in Cohasset, 4 to kids and 2 to adults. One of the talks was to 400 third to fifth graders. And I learned a lesson. You never ask an open-ended question to 400 third to fifth graders. Every single one of them raised their hand. The principal had to step in. It took 10 minutes to calm them down. But after the talk, this little third grade girl came up to me. Oh, she's so cute. We're surrounded by like 100 kids still. And she goes, "I want to get a copy of your book." I said, "Oh, one's been donated to your library. You can read it there." She goes, "No, I want to buy one." I said, "Well, it costs money." She said, "I've got $2 in my pocket." I said, "It's a little more than that." And just to stop you, I know what you're thinking, because I get this every time I tell this story. Why didn't you give her a book? I am not rich enough to hand out 100 books. And there were 100 kids crowded around us, and the teacher was going like this. So I said, "Well, it's a little more than that." She goes, "How about this? How about I give you $2 now, and I'll give you the rest when I'm an adult." So I started laughing. And then she takes one of my business cards, because it was just like that. See, I'm propping that projector up with my business cards. She grabs one of those, and she hands it to me. And she said, if I give you this, will you give me a discount? I have no idea what she's going to do in her life, but I know she's going to be a great success. Now, just tell you, Bruce has already shown you, but I really like the covers of my books. I'm very involved in that. I usually pick the image and the title of the book, and then a designer puts it together. But this is that cover. This is the China book cover. You go to the Peabody Essex Museum, that is Cleopatra's barge, and one of the rooms in that is recreated in the museum. And here is the fur trade book. That painting of the Green River in Wyoming by Edward Moran in the 1870s sold at a Christie's auction a couple of years ago for $17.2 million. It's about twice the size of this screen, I think. And here's the whaling book. This is a very common scene that you would have seen a whale smashing into a whale boat. But with that, I'm done with my talk.
Thank you very much.